Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Let's open in a word of prayer. Lord, thank you for this time together where we can study your word and gather as saints to fellowship. We are grateful and thankful for that opportunity and the country we live in to still do that. I pray that this time is edifying, that we take advantage of that, and we allow your spirit to take these truths you have for us and let it work in our inner man and out through us to the world around us. Amen. So, Ephesians chapter 2, my message title is Keeping God's House in Order. And in Ephesians chapter 2, if you look at verse 19, there's some terminology here. And I was trying to think of analogies to use for this message. What's great about the Bible is the Bible uses illustrations and analogies all the time. So you don't really even have to try that hard. It's better just finding what the Bible uses to describe the doctrinal principles it's trying to relate and just use those. And so here in Ephesians 2, Paul uses the example of a household. So in verse 9, it says, "Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord." And so that term there in 21 where it says, fitly framed together. So he's talking about the household and how everything fits perfectly. And I want to look at 3 points today. And I think that the first point is how right division and understanding dispensationalism, if you don't apply that to the scripture, it's going to lead to confusion. When you approach God's Bible, it leads to confusion. The second point is understanding God's plan in filling the heaven and earth with Israel and the body of Christ. And the third point is the fulfillment of that plan and purpose in eternity. What does that look like in the ages to come in the future? So hopefully we'll be able to touch on all of these a little bit. So why don't we turn to Leviticus chapter 26 and Ephesians 1. And what I want to do is run a bunch of verses real quick here just to prove the first point. We're not going to spend a lot of time, but what I want to do is look at a couple verses, compare them, and just come to the conclusion on whether you think they're saying the same thing or they're saying something different. So turn to Leviticus 26 and Ephesians chapter 1. So you're going to get your workout this morning with flipping pages because we're going to be all over the place. Leviticus 26 and Ephesians chapter 1. In Leviticus chapter 26, if you look at verse, you could go through the whole verse here, the whole chapter, but I'm going to just hit a few verses here to prove the point. Verse 2 of chapter 26, "Ye shall keep my commandment, my Sabbaths, and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. If ye walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then will I give you rain in due season." And he goes on to explain that I will bless you with these blessings if you obey my laws. Now, if you look at verse 14, "But, so in contrast to that, if ye will not hearken unto me and will not do all these commandments, and if ye despise my statutes," and then he goes on to describe how he's going to curse them if they don't follow the rules. Now, if you look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, I think most of us are familiar with this. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places." So here's an example where Paul's saying, you're already blessed with all these spiritual blessings. There's no contract here. There's no if-then. If you do this, if you don't do that, something's going to happen. In Romans chapter 8, verse 32, he says, "He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not also freely give us all things?" Okay, so now let's look at Matthew 3 and 1 Corinthians 1. Matthew chapter 3 and 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Matthew chapter 3, and this is talking about John the Baptist in verse 1. "In those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Look at verse 6, or verse 5. "Then went out all of them, all of the, him, Jerusalem." Let me restart that. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 16, Paul says, "And I baptized also the household of Stephanas. Besides, I know not whether I baptized any other. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect." So you have John the Baptist baptizing and repenting. If you look at Mark 16, it's very clear that if you don't repent and get baptized, you were not saved. Here, Paul says, "I only baptized a couple people, and my job's not to baptize, because that's not how you're getting saved." A few other examples. Look at Romans 4 and James 2. Romans chapter 4 and James chapter 2. This is a very, when you look at Martin Luther and what he did in the Reformation there, one thing he had a problem with was the book of James. And we've been able to have some more light shed on this and come to a better understanding since his days. We've grown upon what he started. And it's amazing, because he would look at this and he would almost go as far as to say we shouldn't even have the book of James. There was something wrong with it, because what he saw was such a contradiction between James 2 and Romans 4. So James 2, verse 24, "See ye then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith alone." Then Romans 4, verse 4, "Now to him that worketh is a reward not reckoned of grace but of debt. But to him that worketh not but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness." And for the sake of time, let me just give you a few other ones here. You have the issue of the dietary rules. You have in Leviticus, they're told they can't eat any swine. You know, he gives them very strict orders about certain fowl, certain beasts they can eat. But then Paul says in 1 Timothy 4, "For every creature of God is good, and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving." You have the issue of the provisions of living. Should you be saving money, making money, having a job? In Mark 6, 8, Jesus commands and says that they should take nothing for their journey save a staff only, no scrip, no bread, no money in their purse. But in 1 Timothy 5, verse 8, Paul says, "But if any man provide not for his own, especially of those of his own house, he hath denied the faith and is worse than an infidel." The issue of following the law. In Deuteronomy, it says you keep all these laws. We looked in Leviticus chapter 26 as well, where it said these are the things you have to do. But in Romans 6:14, Paul says, "For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace." So after looking at these verses, let's say this was your first day coming into church, and this is the first time you've opened the Bible. Could you approach us and say that all these verses say and mean the same thing? They don't. They obviously very clearly say different things. So if that's the case, you would be coming to this with some confusion, right? You'd be like, well, why do all these things look different? Now, Paul says that God is not the author of confusion. In Titus 1, it says that God cannot lie. So if we're working through the process here, we come to God's word, we see differences, we see things that don't match, things that are complete opposites, really. But if there's not supposed to be confusion and God can't lie, then there has to be something we're going to be looking for to solve this problem, right? Wouldn't that make sense? Now, that's the logical way to approach this. Now, here's where it gets tricky. Why do we have so many denominations in the world? Why is Christianity so divided and we have Baptists and Lutherans and Catholics, and they have all these different doctrinal stances and understandings? Because they approach God's word from different ways. And so I would argue that there's three ways that people approach Scripture when they come to these issues, when they come with verses that have different meanings or say different stuff. The first one is they ignore it. Maybe you've been there, maybe you know someone you've talked to that's done that, and they'll approach a Scripture and you'll show these verses and they'll say, "Yeah, but that's not what it really means." That's ignoring it, okay? And we've all heard that, and maybe we've all been there before. So you just ignore it. You excuse it away, or you pretend it's not there at all. The second point that you do is you spiritualize it. And this one's really common today. In the society we live in, especially, the term "your truth." You guys heard that a lot now? When you're talking to people about Scripture, what they approach God's word kind of as just a vending machine of little nuggets and verses that are all separate and independent of each other. And they pick the one that feels best for them that morning with their cup of coffee. And then the next day, it's a different one. And so when you come to problems in the scripture, what they'll do is they'll say, well, you know, the verse speaks to me this way. I know that's what it says, but, you know, a better translation would have been this. Or, you know, really what the author meant is this. Or a great example is Israel. And that's what we're going to talk about primarily is Israel and the body of Christ. What they do is they say, well, we are Israel today. We are spiritual Israel. We've replaced them spiritually. Because they know we haven't replaced them literally. We aren't the descendants. We aren't Jews. We aren't descendants from Abraham in that sense. Where we're given that those promises of the Old Testament. And so they will spiritualize it. And the third point, and this is the one that is the right answer to the question, is you have to rightly divide the word of truth. That's 2 Timothy 2:15. You have to understand and make divisions in God's word and properly apply it dispensationally today. And when you do that, these issues, these verses we looked at, the issues of tongues and spiritual gifts, bringing the kingdom to earth, being worried about what's going on in Israel and the promised land today, looking for end time prophecy, the simple basic truth of understanding your gospel, like in Galatians chapter 2. When you read Galatians chapter 2, verse 7, and Paul says that he was sent to the uncircumcision with the gospel, and Peter the gospel to the circumcision. Those are two different gospels. Most of the church today would believe there's a gospel, a singular gospel. And so without dispensationalism, without rightly dividing the word of truth, you lose that clarity. And so when I said keeping the household of God in order, what the church has done today is they've made a mess of what God's designed and planned. God has a purpose. He has order. He's not the author of confusion. And everything he does has a design and a plan and a purpose. And when we approach God's word, turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. When we approach God's word, apart from what God, how God intends us to do it, and instead we imply our wisdom, human wisdom, or our logic, or what we want it to be, that's where we get the confusion. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, it says, "For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe." You see there he says, you received it as it is the truth. See, God's word is truth. It's not your truth. It's not your interpretation of truth. It is the truth. It's how you approach it that decides how it applies to your life. Because at the end of the verse it says that effectually worketh also in you that believe. If you're not approaching God's word in faith and identifying it as your truth, as your final authority, I would argue that the way the Holy Spirit's going to work in your life is not going to be effective. Because you're strangling the source by which the Holy Spirit is fed and how you operate by faith in your life. That's the way it's done today. And so if you are ignoring dispensationalism, you're spiritualizing verses, you're going back to the Greek to decide what you think a better translation is, you are not approaching God's word by faith and as being the truth for you today. You're going about to establish your own. And so the fundamental issue we have to do whenever we approach God's word is understand it's God's word and it's the truth. And we are not the issue. God is the issue. Now, the term dispensationalism, if you haven't heard that before, to keep it very simple, dispensationalism is just God is dispensing. The word means to dispense something. So God, throughout the Bible, is dispensing different information at different time. Now, I've heard personally, when you talk to people about this, maybe you have more objections, but the two main objections I've heard is, number one, it's wrong to cut up the Bible like that. Well, you're saying that Paul's your apostle. So wait, you just ignore the rest of the Bible? Well, why do you ignore the rest of the Bible? What about the Old Testament? What about the letters in red? Why do you ignore those? Aren't as important as Paul's? Has anyone ever heard that one before? Okay. Now, if you're honest with yourself, if everyone was honest with themselves, everyone to a certain extent applies dispensationalism. And I know that because people aren't out there building an ark. Who's out there building an ark today? Why not? Well, who did God tell to build an ark? Noah. He didn't tell you that, right? And you know he's not going to flood the earth again, so there's no point. So there's an example right there where you're identifying something that was written, that is truth, that had a purpose at a time that doesn't apply to you today. So the idea that it's wrong to divide the word or to have understand dispensational truths is just not true. The second point, turn to 2 Timothy 2:15. Grab 2 Timothy 2:15 and also grab Genesis chapter 1. Second Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Both these verses you guys probably already know. Verse 15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And that's a verse that we like to preach here because that's the key verse to understanding God's word. But who's ever heard someone say, well, but there's only one verse that says rightly dividing the word of truth? So you're going to base all of this understanding of the scripture and how you divide the dispensations in the Bible based off of one verse. And by the way, that one verse in other Bible translations doesn't read rightly dividing. So, you know, you can think what you want about that. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. What is God doing right there in the very first verse of the Bible? He's dividing. Is he making a distinction? Heaven and earth. So the idea that just because there's one verse that says rightly divide, which means to cut straight, to make proper cuts and divisions, just because that's only used one time doesn't mean there's many examples in Scripture where you have obvious divisions taking place. And that's the key one I want to focus on today, heaven and earth. So in the very beginning of the Bible, and this is important too, man approaches God's word as the way they approach, at least nowadays, the way they approach other books today, which is it's kind of like you're just your little self-help book, and when you're feeling down, you read it and you pick a verse. And the Bible is much bigger and more important than you. Now, that doesn't mean God doesn't love you and care about you. You read in the Bible and you find out how much he loves you and cares for you, what his son did to save you from your sins. But God has got a lot more going on today and has a lot in plan, more than just worrying about giving you a verse to make you feel good in the morning. It's not just a bunch of random verses put together. There's order to it. There's a design. So when he says heaven and earth, he is making a distinction. And we looked at, and go back to Ephesians chapter 2, so very, to make a quick overview of the Old Testament, when he says in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, from that point on, the earth is the subject of everything God does. Israel is God's people, chosen people, on the earth. What is Abraham promised? David. They're all promised a land to rule and reign where? On the earth. The Old Testament is completely focused on that. And what we call even today the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and even the beginning of Acts, is still focused on that. We read the verse where John says he came baptizing for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And people say, well, he said kingdom of heaven. But if you read other verses and you go to Revelation, that kingdom is being held in heaven. It's being reserved in heaven to be brought down to the earth. And so in Revelation, when he says he makes a new heaven and a new earth, Israel's plan and purpose was to be a part of that. I told you to turn to Ephesians chapter 2, right? Okay. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Make you flip one page. Verse 19. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. And so here in Ephesians, and we know Paul's epistles, you see a shift from the heaven to, from earth being the focus of the Bible to the heaven being the focus of the Bible. And Ephesians is a wonderful book that talks about the heaven all the time. We read verse 3 earlier, you're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Ephesians 2, verse 6, it says, he hath raised us up together and made us sit in heavenly places in Christ. And so you see that God's focus and what he's doing through the Apostle Paul and through the body of Christ today has a heavenly calling and purpose. And so the second point I want to look at today is, how does that work? And again, when we think about the illustration of the household of God and everything being fitly framed together, how does that work when it comes to Israel on the earth and the body of Christ in the heavens? And so in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 10, look at verse 4 first. And so, and before I read this, let me just mention this too. In Ephesians 1, verse 20, we talked about it filling all in all, that Christ is going to fill. So he mentions the heavens and the earth, and he's talking about filling it. So what we want to look at is what is the design and plan for filling something? So if you think about your house, and especially women, they're much better at this than us guys. But if you have a home and you've built it and you've framed it a certain way, do you have a design and a plan for how you're going to put your home together? And you're going to fill it with something, right? Now you might be able to go to a guy's house and it could be completely empty. You could just have like a bed and a TV and that's it, and they'd be happy. But women like to put the pictures on the wall, and you have to have shelves, and every 3 or 4 years you got to change it, or maybe every year, depending on how it works. We just remodeled our basement over the summer because my wife had a great idea of the house. It's a mess down there. We need to get it in order. So it started just with, well, let's just buy some shelves and organize our stuff. And then it was, well, while we're doing that, we might as well paint the walls before we put the shelves up. And the ceiling's looking kind of crummy. We should paint the ceiling. And by the time we had done one section of the basement, well, we might as well do the other section. And the floor's looking bad. And so before you know it, 2 months later, we've put in floors and painted the walls, painted the ceilings. And then I was able to get my own little man cave space with 2 TVs on the wall. See, all the women, they go, oh, why? And the guys are like, oh, man, that's nice. You need 2 TVs. See, if you can watch hockey and a show at the same time, that's multitasking. See, when my wife said I can't multitask, I proved her wrong. Give me 2 TVs, I can do double, I can waste time double. But anyways, there's a design, right, and an order. And when you create this household, you're going to fill it. And so God does that with the heaven and the earth. So in Ephesians chapter 1, what I want to look at here is we're going to kind of bounce between what God's doing with Israel and what God's doing with the body of Christ. And we're going to see some similarities, but we're going to see differences too. So in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now that term holy, that means to be set apart, to be different, to be set apart for a purpose. And that's what he's talking about in verse 4 here, where he says you're predestinated. It's not that God's, like with Calvinism, what they do is they take this and say, okay, God is predetermining each individual that he's going to save. So if God's choosing an individual to be saved before the beginning of time, then he's also going to be choosing those who are going to be damned before the foundation of time, right? See, that's the problem. But you're not reading that as God saving the individual. What you're seeing is he predetermined the body of Christ is what he's talking about. An entity, a vessel that he's going to use to accomplish his plan and purpose in the heavens. That's what Ephesians 1 and 4 is talking about. Now, the next point we're going to look at, we'll look at how you get placed into that. But it's important to realize God's plan since the foundation of the world, which, by the way, he kept secret. We don't hear anything about the body of Christ in the Old Testament. It's only about Israel. It's only about his plan on the earth. It's not until the Apostle Paul we find out, hey, he also had a group of people he was going to gather together with a purpose and a plan for the heavens. In verse 10 of Ephesians, this is the big idea. So when I said God's got a plan, this is what I'm talking about. Verse 10, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in where? And which are even in him. So see, he's saying, here's the plan. The reason that I've done this is because my goal, and we're going to look at this at the end of the message, is Christ is the head of the church. Christ is the head of the household. And I've designed it so that he's the head over the heaven and the earth. All things center under his son. That's his big plan. That's his big idea. And so we see that taking place. Now, I mentioned in Ephesians 1:4 how it's called holy, right? We're set apart to a purpose, the body of Christ. But look also at Exodus chapter 19. Exodus chapter 19. Exodus chapter 19, verse 5. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. So what is he talking about here, the heaven or the earth? And what people is he referring to here? Israel. Again, context is so important too. That's the danger with just reading a devotional book. I'm not saying you shouldn't read those. I'm not trying to bash them too much. But the Bible is written in order, and so if there's an order, it has context. And so when you just grab a verse, well, you can miss the context a lot sometimes. So it's important we always look at that context. Verse 6, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And there he says, holy nation. So Israel also is called to be a holy nation. They're set apart for a purpose. And so if you look at the issue of election, that's the first thing I want to look at. Look at Isaiah 44. Isaiah chapter 44. And we've already looked at in Ephesians chapter 1 about that predestination and how you're called into that calling and that service. And the idea is that when you accept by faith that free gift of eternal life, you get placed into the body of Christ, which has been set apart for a plan and a purpose and for service. In Isaiah, what I want to look at is Israel's plan. So chapter 44, verse 1, yea, now hear, O Jacob, my servant, and Israel whom I have chosen. So the nation has been chosen. Now, we understand that there's a national issue a lot of times in the Old Testament, and there's also the individual issue. So like we read in Matthew chapter 3, John the Baptist is only going to Israel, right? He's not going to the Gentiles. But he's calling them out to be baptized into the little flock. He's looking for the individuals by faith and the work of baptism to be called into the little flock. Look at chapter 45, Isaiah 45, verse 4. For Jacob, my servant's sake, and Israel, mine elect, have I called thee by thy name. So again, here you can see that Israel is being called. God has designed in the Old Testament that through Israel, through Jacob's seed, he's going to create his agency to rule on the earth. The second point is baptism. Now, we already looked at Matthew 3, so grab 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And grab Ephesians chapter 1, too. Ephesians chapter 1 and 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So we already looked at how, and just the point of baptism is you're being placed into something, right? So holy means it's set apart. It's got a design and a purpose. And the baptism is you the individual being placed into that plan, into that vessel, into that purpose. And so we see how with Israel, like we just read in Matthew 3 in the beginning of the message, that's what John the Baptist was doing. In Mark 16, Jesus is telling his apostles the same thing. Even in the beginning of Acts 2, you still hear that same message from the 12 at Pentecost. Now in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So you see, when you accept by faith, it has nothing to do with whether you're a Jew or a Gentile, you're not under Israel's program. Today, in the age of grace, everybody is either in Adam or they're in Christ. Those are the two distinctions. And when you by faith trust that what Christ did on the cross for your sins was a fully satisfying payment, that trust in his finished work, the Spirit indwells you at that moment and seals you. And when it does that, that's, if you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, that, chapter 12, verse 13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jew or Gentile, whether be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. That's the process right there. It's the Holy Spirit. You don't need water to get placed into the body of Christ today. You need the Holy Spirit. And just like you did nothing to earn your salvation, you do nothing to be placed in that into the body of Christ. You're not going down to the river and getting baptized. And so, amen. And so the baptism is what places you into that into the body of Christ. Turn to Deuteronomy 14 and Titus chapter 2. Told you guys are going to be flipping all over the place today. Titus chapter 2 and Deuteronomy chapter 14. So in Deuteronomy chapter 14, look at verse 2. So this is, again, talking about Israel. For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God, and the Lord hath chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto him above all the nations that are upon the earth. So let's think again here about context. Is he making a distinction between Israel and all the nations upon the earth? Like I said earlier, in Paul's epistles, in the dispensation we live in today of grace, Romans 5 is clear that you're either in Adam or you're in Christ. And Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13 and 14 talks about how that middle wall of partition is broken down. There is no more the distinction between Israel and Gentiles today. But you notice he calls them a peculiar people. And if you turn to Titus chapter 2, Paul uses that same word to describe the body of Christ. In Titus chapter 2, verse 14, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. And so if you think about, again, the illustration of a house, let's say you have a shelf in your house, and you have a vessel that you put on there, a vase, a vase. Now, you're going to fill it with something. So in the Old Testament, God's taking Israel, that's his chosen vessel to accomplish his purpose, and he's filling it. And he says that they're a peculiar people. Now, in the Old Testament, you go through Leviticus and Deuteronomy, and what do you get? A bunch of rules and regulations. And sometimes you wonder, why can I only eat certain meats? And why do we have to have all these ceremonies and all these religious days? What it does is it creates them a uniqueness between them and the Gentiles. They look peculiar. They look weird. Why are you doing that? Why do you wear certain clothes? I mean, you go through the Old Testament, there's a lot of things that they're told to do, very detailed stuff about their appearance, what they eat, what they wear, all that stuff. Now, in the book, in Titus, Paul says that we're a peculiar people, the body of Christ. And in verse 12 there, it says, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. If you're doing that today and you're allowing God's word to work out through you and you are living soberly, righteously, and godly, are you going to look weird in this world? Are you going to be peculiar? I'm sure you guys experience this. The things that you watch, the things you talk about at the water cooler at work, what you're doing right now on Sunday morning. This is peculiar now. This is not the normal thing anymore. So you see, God's, as the body of Christ, we also are a peculiar people, a different vessel on a different shelf of God's household, but designed for a purpose, and we're peculiar. Now, the next point I want to look at is, so God's created this vessel. People are being identified and put into it for a purpose of work and service, where it's peculiar. What's God going to do? When the time comes, life doesn't go on like this. Sin has to be dealt with. What is God going to do with those vessels he's created and the people that have been put into it? So if you look at Matthew chapter 25, and look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 31, it says in verse 31, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And you read, if you go in Revelation chapter 19, 20, 21 there, you hear more about how him coming down from heaven and coming to the earth to set up his throne, to sit, to rule and reign on his throne on the earth. Now, if you look at 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Now you see there he said, Christ is going to descend from heaven in verse 16 with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. But then notice in verse 17, then we which are alive and remain. So first the dead are going to go up. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord where? Is the air a different space than the land? Yes. So in Matthew 25, when Christ comes down to the earth to reign, and by the way, what does he tell his 12 apostles that they're going to be doing? Judging, ruling, they're going to be reigning over the 12 tribes of Israel on the earth. So when you, this is a big problem here. This is where the spiritualizing comes in today. Israel is on the earth. When you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it is not a spiritual kingdom God is talking about. That's what people want to do today. Everything Jesus said is you spiritualize it. It is a literal, physical, visible kingdom on the earth that Israel will be ruling and reigning. And you go back to Isaiah and you see how they're supposed to be that light to the world, and then the Gentiles are going to come unto them because they're seeing them as God's chosen people functioning the way they're supposed to. But here in 1 Thessalonians 4, you can see the body of Christ meets him in the air. God does not come all the way down to the earth. And this is, right, not yet. And that's why you know these are two different times that are happening. Matthew 25 is a different situation than what 1 Thessalonians 4 is. They're not the same thing happening. And so we're caught up to meet him in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. And isn't it interesting? We're going up in the air because where is our eternal glory and purpose? It's in the heavens. There's no point for us to hang out down here anymore at this point. We go up. The prophetic prophecy starts up again. You have the tribulation, the millennial, and eventually you have the culmination of everything where God finally does what his entire plan was, which is to bring heaven and earth under his Son. And so you see that we're caught up into the air. And if you look at we'll grab Revelation 21 real quick. I kind of already mentioned this, but let's just get a verse to put with it. Revelation 21. And also grab 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So in Revelation chapter 21, verse 1, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So you see, like when it talks about in 1 Peter, or it might be Hebrews, where it says that it's reserved in heaven, this is that heaven coming down to the earth. So this is talking about Israel and that kingdom coming to the earth. So Israel's election and their plan of service and purpose designed by God is to be ruling on the earth. You contrast that with the body of Christ in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with heavens, eternal in the where? In the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. And so, and you have other examples. In Philippians 3:21, it talks about our conversation in heaven. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, it says that, and hath seated us together in heavenly places. You see all these examples in Paul's epistles where you can clearly tell that the end game, the end purpose and plan for the body of Christ is a heavenly purpose and calling. And so I hope you're seeing the clear distinction between heaven and earth. So when he says in Genesis 1:1, God created the heaven and the earth, you see how Israel clearly fits into the earth, and the body of Christ clearly is designed for the heavens. And it's so important. So when we talk about dispensationalism or right division, you can see how you have to make those divisions. And all those verses we read in the beginning that obviously were different, that someone who's ripping the Bible would say contradict each other. Well, I guess you could say they contradict in the sense that they don't say the same thing, but they fitly join together in God's word if you're rightly dividing. They aren't an issue if you approach God's word by faith and as by truth. And you know, just a side note, this is why the Bible issue is important. Understanding God's word in the King James Bible that we have today, you can't do that in the modern translations. Pull out your blue letter Bible and Google and put in the search bar for NIV dispensation. You know what's going to come up? Nothing. So what happens to Ephesians chapter 3, where Paul clearly defines that he has a distinct apostleship to the Gentiles, a dispensation that was committed to him? It's such an 2 Timothy 2:15, another example. Or Galatians chapter 2, where it clearly says Paul had one gospel and Peter had another. It dilutes that. It makes that not that clear line of distinction is now washed away, and it's kind of muddied. And so when we have the confusion in our church today, that's part of the reason right there is the Bible issue. So that's something to consider and to look at that if you haven't yet. So anyways, going on to the last point, what God's accomplishing, right? He's created Israel on the earth. He's created the body of Christ for the heaven. And that end goal, if you look at Colossians chapter 1, and grab Ephesians chapter 3. And we don't have the time to go into all of this, but what's so fascinating is God creates this plan, and we find out from Ephesians 1 that before the foundation of the earth, he had this plan for the body of Christ. Now, he keeps that part a secret. We look at Romans 16:25. It talks about how that was something, what Paul had was not preached by the prophets of the old. That was not something that was known in the Old Testament. So God is able to create this simple plan, secret plan, which in a way, I mean, it cost him something in his Son, but isn't it fascinating how he uses man? He takes man who's created by earth, dirt and spit. But what he's able to do is then, in 1 Corinthians 15, what kind of body are we given? Are we still going to have the physical earthly body when we go up to heaven? No, we're going to be given a new body. We're going to be clothed with that spiritual body. So see, he all this stuff he's thought through. And he's done all this while Satan leads a rebellion in the heavens and the earth. Mankind in their sin is constantly messing up. And you read if you read the first 12 chapters of Genesis, you see how God gives them a real simple plan. Don't eat that tree. That's the only thing you don't have to do. Everything else you can freely eat. And they rebel and they sin. Okay, well here, I'll give you some rules. I'll write them in a book. You can't mess it up now. And what do? And all through Scripture, you see man constantly rebelling against God, constantly in unbelief. And yet through all of that, God is able to let man maintain their free will to choose and still be able to create a heavenly and an earthly vessel to fulfill his purpose. And whoever is in those vessels are in it because they chose to be in it. They use their free will. God didn't force them to do it. And so God's end game is, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself. Colossians 1, verse 16. Colossians 1, 16. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, things were created by him and for him. And when he talks about those principalities and those powers, when we think of the earthly realm and the heavenly realm, they have those similarities, right? What we see here on the earth is going to be similar to what's going on in the heavens with the principalities and the powers. So if you're created for a purpose, and that purpose is service, you've been set aside to it, this is the kind of stuff that we're going to be doing, that we're going to be placed into in the body of Christ in the ages to come. You know, if you go back to the book of Daniel, when Nebuchadnezzar makes that statue, and he calls everyone together, do you notice all, if you read that, there's like a dozen different levels of authority that he names there, all these different positions. And we know today, by the way, in our government, there's way too many governmental positions and structures. We could probably consolidate a little bit. But you see that structure. That's what he's talking about. All of that in heaven and earth, God is going to bring together to one. Verse 17, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, which is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all the fullness dwell. And so God's end game, we read in Ephesians 1:10 there, the focus of heaven and earth being under his Son. It's God's desire to give to his Son the heavens and the earth to reign, to be the head over it. So in Ephesians 2, when he talks about the whole house being fitly framed together, we're a part of that, Israel's a part of that, and God is, Jesus Christ is the head over all of that. And that's the end game that he's trying to get to. And so if you turn to Philippians 2, we'll close here. Philippians 2 is great because you see, while in Colossians 1, the Father, it pleased the Father to give to his Son to be the head over all things. In Philippians 2, you see the mind of Christ to his Father. Philippians 2:5. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth. Now you notice there's three realms here now? We've been talking about heaven and earth this whole time, but you notice that there's something under the earth there? You know what? In the culmination of time, the end of things, when everything is under him, those three realms, even the people who in unbelief and rebellion rejected God, their knee is still going to bow to God. And it's important today that we make the right decision on where we're going to, what realm we're going to be in. And that's a free will choice. That to me is so fascinating. The problem with a lot of religion today is that the idea of God allowing us to have free will is taken away. Calvinism, that's the biggest problem. The free will is gone. And then I've seen so many friends and family who have been ruined because they start to think, well, if I don't have a choice, then what does it matter? And when you realize that every knee is going to bow in heaven, in earth, and under the earth, and everyone is there because they chose to be there, because God loved them so much to give them the free will to choose who they want to serve, where they want to be. And so if you haven't made that decision today, you need to make that decision. God does love you. It says God commended his love toward us and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ did all the work for you. There's not a law anymore you got to follow. There's not one rule you have to follow. You don't have to go through the commandments. You don't need to do Sabbath. You don't have to eat certain food. God loves you so much, he did everything for you. All he asks you to do is to trust him. He can't make it any easier for you because you aren't doing anything. You put your trust and your faith in what Christ did for you on the cross as full payment for your sin. It's all he asks. And that's what's so wonderful when you believe that truth, and hopefully you have, and if you haven't, that will open your eyes to what we've been talking to you today. Because when you read Ephesians 1, when he says you're blessed with all spiritual blessings, and you go through and you see how he's got a plan and a purpose for us in the heavens, that's amazing. That's powerful. And that, by the way, is what is sobering to us to take it seriously now. Because then we realize, wow, so what I'm doing now is God allowing me to learn and grow by free will still, right? You can choose to study this Bible. You can get saved today and never open the Bible again and you're still going to heaven. But even once you're saved, God still allows your free will under grace. That's what's amazing about grace. It doesn't take away your free will. You choose now. Are you going to keep studying and growing in God's Word or not? And that's your choice. And he loves you no matter what, and you go to heaven no matter what. But your plan and purpose is tied to how you study and take God's Word now. And that's why it's important that we take it seriously. So let's be that peculiar treasure that God has called us out to be in the body of Christ today. Let's be that light to the world, ambassadors for him. Lord, thank you for this time again. Yeah, I'm so thankful for your Son and your love and grace and just the wisdom you had before the foundation of the earth to plan this out the way you did and to allow us to be a part of it and give us the choice to do that so that we can serve you with free will and we can serve you willingly and happily in the age.